All right, so we're right about the halfway point here in both Steiner's commentary on the Gospel of Mark. This is lecture number 6 out of 10, and we're on chapter 8 of the Mark Gospel. And there's 16 chapters there, so we're halfway through in both cases. So what Steiner does in this chapter is he contrasts the Indian worldview of history as an ever-recurring cycle of ages with the worldview in the Old Testament and in the West generally, as a single linear arc that's never to be repeated. Christ is only incarnates one time, and for Steiner, he never reincarnates after that. It's just a one-time only event. And everything in the Bible is a one-time only event. But if we look at the Hindu model first, and Steiner does a bit, he doesn't go into this kind of detail or talk about the yugas. But the basic model is that there are four yugas, which correspond to four different throws of the dice, but it's also depicted as the four legs of a cow that gradually loses one of its legs so that it's standing on three, then two, then perilously on one leg. So the perfect dice throw is a krita, which means the winning throw, and that's the first of these ages. It's the first and the longest, and then that's an age, that's a golden age in which dharma is at its maximum, virtue is at its maximum. People perform selfless acts. They don't have to be told or instructed in all of this, and society is humming right along perfectly. Then there's a decline of virtue by a quarter down to the Trita Yuga, which means three. Trita and three are related, and the cow's on three legs. Then there's a loss of a quarter of dharma, of virtue, a slow, gradual decline into the Dvapara Yuga. Dvapara is related to the word for two, duo. And the cow now is only on two legs. And then finally, when it's perched on one leg, it's the Kali Yuga, which was said to have begun in this particular cycle in 3102 BC. And the dates, the lengths for each of these, the Kali Yuga is to last 432,000 years, but the Dvapara Yuga is before it, is to last twice that, 864,000 years. And then the Trita Yuga before that lasts for twice that, 1,296,000 years. And then for the Krita Yuga, it lasts 1,728,000 years, all of which adds up to a complete Mahayuga of 4,320,000 years. 1,000 of these Mahayugas adds up to a Kalpa, which is one day in the life of the god Brahma. Brahma sits on the lotus and he has four faces that generate the light of consciousness out into the four quarters. And he is sort of like the movie projector, projecting Vishnu's dream of the world out into space and time as Maya. And Vishnu himself incarnates through 10 avatars. It actually adds up to 11 because I think they've inserted the Buddha in at a later date. But 10 avatars ideally across these four avatars, naturally for the Krita Yuga, which are the four Matya, since each one of these Mahayugas ends with a great flood in which the flood hero Manu comes. And Matya, Vishnu is incarnated as Matya the fish, who helps Manu. So he's the Noah figure. So we have the Matya incarnation followed by the tortoise, Kurma. In Indian cosmology, the world rests on the back of a giant turtle. Mount Meru rests on the back of a giant turtle. So we have Matya, Kurma, then the boar, Varaha, which is the incarnation of Vishnu when he incarnates as a boar. And he has to rescue the earth goddess. The earth herself is captured by an elephant demon and carried down to the bottom of the watery abyss. Vishnu incarnates as a boar, sort of with a man's body and a boar's head, goes down and uses his tusks to dig up the earth, i.e. to save the earth goddess, and brings her back to the surface. And then she says, every time we do this, you carry me the same way, because this has happened an infinite number of times in India. The world constantly recurs. Over and over and over again, the exact same events playing out. The fourth incarnation in the Krita Yuga is Narasimha, the man lion. But then there are three incarnations, naturally, for the Trita Yuga, which is Vamana, the dwarf, who takes three steps, each one larger than the other, the dwarf incarnation, and that's followed by Parashu Rama, not the Rama from the Ramayana, but the Rama with the axe. And then finally Rama, the Rama from the Ramayana, so that the events of the Ramayana take place during the Trita Yuga, even though it's not as old as the Mahabharata, which is, I think, the older epic. But the Mahabharata then takes place in the next epoch. So we've got four incarnations in Krita Yuga, three incarnations in the Treta Yuga, two incarnations in the Dvapara Yuga, which are Krishna, as we have seen, but also his brother Balarama. They sort of split an avatar between them and incarnate in the Dvapara Yuga. And this is when the events of the Mahabharata take place at the end of the Dvapara Yuga. And it signals the great war that takes place there, signals sort of the Hindu version of their version of the Trojan War, the shift into the Kali Yuga, 3102, where we have only the lone incarnation of the Buddha. But I think that was added later because there's another incarnation at the end of the Kali Yuga who is still to come, named Kalki. And Kalki is a warrior who rides on a white steed and will vanquish all the foes of evil. And then the whole thing starts all over again, back to the next Yuga or Maha Yuga. So it's an endlessly recurring cycle, world without end, as Joyce puns on it in Finnegan's Wake. Whereas now in the West, we have a single linear trajectory, which is first, so far as I know, is first crystallized actually by the Persians with Zarathustra, who must date sometime from about the year 1000 BC. Some scholars say 500 BC. I think it's more likely 1000 BC because the language of the Gathas that he wrote in is very similar to Sanskrit, so the two peoples cannot have been very far apart. So he probably dates from about 1000, wherein he conceives of history as a single trajectory of 12,000 years, divided into four epochs of 3,000 years each. There's a fall. We have the god of light, Ahura Mazda, who creates a universe of light. Then there's his counterpart. It's based on cosmic dualism, Angra Mainyu, who becomes the prototype for Satan. The Hebrews will pick that character up and transform him into Satan when they're restored from their Babylonian captivity by Cyrus the Great. And then it moves through this arc, and about halfway through world history comes Zarathustra himself to bring the good news, basically his gospel, which is right deeds, right works, performing your duties in service to society, upholding the cosmic virtue that we already saw was declining in the Hindu model. And then finally, at the end of history will come the Saushant, who corresponds to Kalki, they're roughly the same figure, who will come at the end of history to restore the original purity of the original age. All the damned will be, a meteorite will crash into the earth and it will destroy all the damned, and the saved will be taken up into paradise. That's only going to happen one time for the Persians. And the same thing as Steiner says here with the Old Testament, the Hebrews are really the first in the West to create this kind of one-shot trajectory. We just have one Genesis. We have an age of judges that is never repeated, that goes into an age of kings, never repeated, with an age of prophets that's never repeated. Then finally the Maccabean revolt. Then we have the Christ event. And then eventually we're going to have the end of history with the book of Revelation and the final apocalypse and the second coming of Christ. One trajectory, one shot, so that every single thing that happens is a singularity and is absolutely unique, hence the historical emphasis in the Old Testament on recounting. The Hebrews had a very historical consciousness. They kept track of everything and they remembered everything. So that's the Old Testament. And then, so Steiner, from Mark 8 here, he gives an example of the kind of uniqueness of the Christ event for him, which is him. He has just broken, keep in mind here, from the Theosophists over the issue of their putting forth Jiddu Krishnamurti as the reincarnation of Christ. And Steiner says in this passage, no, that can never happen. There can never be another Christ event. And he quotes from Mark 8, where Jesus and the disciples have just come from Caesarea Philippi. And Christ says, "Who do men say that I am?" When he asks his disciples, and they say, John the Baptist, others say Elijah, others one of the prophets. Then he turns to Peter and he says, "But who do you say that I am?" And Peter says, "You're the Christ." And then he says, "Don't tell anybody about this. That is to be kept quiet, to be kept a secret, because I will be crucified, killed, and then 3 days later I will rise again." Peter tries to rebuke him, and he turns and he says, "Get thee behind me, Satan. You are on the side here. You are not on the side of God. You are on the side of man here. This is my destiny. In other words, this is something that I've agreed to do and that I have to do." And Steiner says that the key thing about this passage that he says the biblical commentators miss is The significance of the Christ event is to represent a democratization of the mysteries. It's a democratization of what had been hitherto always practiced as the mysteries. So that when Steiner refers to the mystery of Golgotha, he doesn't mean it's a whodunit mystery. He means that this is the mystery which occurs for the first time as a historical fact, a historical actuality, that a God has come down from the sun and taken on the form of a man in order to be crucified and then rise again 3 days later, is to make public what the structures of the mysteries are. Because the reason why he tells Peter to remain silent is because you're not supposed to speak about the mysteries. The people who were initiated into the Eleusinian mysteries were held to keep silent or else, and they did keep silent. This is why in the movie, Stanley Kubrick's movie Eyes Wide Shut, when the Tom Cruise character goes in and into this sexual orgy cult, it's a kind of a Dionysus cult, and they warn him, don't speak of this to anyone or else something bad will happen to you, namely death. So one did not speak about the mysteries, which is why he tells Peter to remain silent about the plan here, because this time it's going to be different. And normally initiates would go in, like in the temple sleep, for instance, as one variation, they would go in and they would sleep for 3 days and they would have dreams. Their astral body would leave their physical body and then come back on the third day. And that was the standard practice for the sleep initiation mystery. Here, Christ is going to enact that three-day event in physical actuality, and the structure of the mysteries for the first time is going to be made public through a historical actual event. And so that's Steiner's reading of this little mysterious passage here, which is otherwise unexplainable. Why does he tell Peter not to let anyone know that he is the Christ? And why does he tell him, get thee behind me, Satan? Steiner says he's actually talking to himself there, not Peter, about his own irresolution and hesitancy to do this. Do I really want to do this? And he has to make the choice to do it. He knows what the plan is. He incarnated as this God being with this intention. Just as before you incarnate, by the way, Steiner says elsewhere, and I've verified this with my own researches through talking with the dead, before you incarnate, not only is it the case that after you die, you have a life review, which everyone who's had a near-death experience, or most people who have, there are variations in them, will tell you that. Yes, I saw my life flashing in front of me. Sometimes it'll be backwards. Steiner says it goes backwards, but I don't think it always does. But then likewise, before you incarnate, you have a life preview. The spirit guides and the angel beings, whoever it is that's in charge of this mysterious process, flash forward, give you a life review, and you have to agree to it. So that certain things are agreed to that will happen to you no matter what. These are called contracts. You make these spiritual contracts. That's your karma. And it doesn't have to be, sometimes it's good things, sometimes it's tragedies, bad things. But you learn from bad things. It's part of the soul's evolution. That's how it grows. You don't learn anything and you don't get stronger by having a nice, smooth, easy life. And you find that out. I'm sure all of us at one point or another have decided to incarnate with a nice, smooth, easy life. We see people all around us all the time who have such lives, who get everything they want. Such individuals, though, I have a feeling when they go back onto the other side, realize that they really haven't grown. You need the tough stuff. That's what makes for spiritual evolution. That's what moves your evolution as a soul along, through enduring the tough stuff, growing from it, not pulling the escape hatch and doing suicide, which is the wrong way out because it doesn't get the karma resolved. So you got to go back and do that contract again because you didn't get it right. That's how it works. And so this passage does suggest that Christ is fully aware of what the plan is, that he is going to be crucified and suffer through this agony, this ordeal. He's nervous about it, you can tell. And he's telling Peter, don't just keep this between you and I. We don't want anyone to know about this because that's part of the nature of the mysteries. If you spoil the mysteries, then who wants to participate? So this becomes the mystery of Golgotha, then becomes, of course, later patterned out in the Catholic Mass, the Mass, and especially the Eucharist with the Last Supper. It all becomes the key toward opening the doors of what for the initiates and in the esoteric traditions was only for the very few. But the Christ event democratizes the mysteries and makes them available for all and sundry. Anyone who wants to participate in the Christ impulse may do so now.